How do I get? And then I just start panicking, and I call Skarsgård, you know, did you see it? And he goes, yes, yes. And I say, okay, send it over. Say it slow, then say it fast. He goes, I. And then it arrives in my email, and, you know, this world of Mac, I click on it, and then it's in iTunes, and then it's on my iPod. And I just play it over and over and over and hope that I'm saying something intelligible. And never know. And on the day, I'll say, okay, don't laugh. And he goes, okay. And then he laughs. But never keeps that bargain. But he will, you know, help me and adjust it. But one day I was like, God, why am I so nervous? You're the only person here who's going to know if I'm, you know, what I'm saying. And he goes, and 9 million Swedes.
I feel like, you know, what Dennis said, that key word about being specific with that is, you know, raise your hand if you're from the South. Now, it'd be silly to say there's such a thing as a Southern accent, because I've sat at a table and people come through, and if you're from one part of Tennessee versus the next, or one, you know, Robert Duvall's a friend of mine, and he has a buddy, Bob Eastman, the linguist and dialect coach, who spent some time researching and said that there are over 200 distinguishable accents in this one part of the Shenandoah Valley. So I think lazy actors and acting book-writing crooks make their Southern accent tape and sell it to people. Yeah. But what he's talking about being specific is, and what they're saying, I think, is you find a person or a kind of person. And I, you know, I grew up in Texas, but for some reason sound like I'm from Brooklyn. But my little cousin Sam is this kind of a basis for Hoyt in a lot of ways, at least where he started. And he kind of sounds like that. And, you know, just kind of felt right. I don't know, kind of felt right. So, yeah.
I was fortunate that... I didn't say what I was fortunate for. You're gonna fill in that blank?
Yeah.
Go Steelers, yeah.
Yeah.
I'm from Pittsburgh, I'm not from the South. Right? There's a very distinct accent from Pittsburgh, which I don't, my parents are from Boston, so one of my first, one of my first words was car. To describe a thing driving. And, but Pittsburgh, you know, they don't say y'all, they say yins. Yins gone downtown and that. And I'm going to watch a Stiller game up in Washington County. So it's a little, it's very specific. But I was lucky, I went to Carnegie Mellon University, and the first 2 years they drill you on this phonetic alphabet to the point where they won't let you write in normal English. You have to write in sound symbols. And the whole idea is to train your ear to be able to hear sound changes in foreign languages and be able to pick things up quicker. And so when I got cast on True Blood, and we decided, well, according to the show, Alcide was from Jackson. Now, I know in the books, he was living in Shreveport, or his father had a company in Shreveport. But, you know, for the sake of having all the werewolves be uniform in season three, you know, he's from Jackson. And so I met with the dialect coach, and I recognized her last name. And I heard her say a word, and I said, where are you from? And she said, I'm from Pittsburgh. and I said, did you teach in Pittsburgh? She said, yeah, I was the head of the speech department at Carnegie Mellon University. I went, are you kidding me? And she, you know, all the books, all of her technique was what I was taught. It was the whole system that I was taught. So it was really easy to pick it up, and we went over tape after tape and voice after voice, but most of the voices I was listening to from Jackson were very, it was a very, kind of like the way Dennis's character talks, very high status. And there was one guy I heard, just one voice on one of the tapes, this guy who was a football player in college, and he went off to Europe, and he rode a motorcycle, and then he came back to Jackson and became a judge. And he was on the front page of the paper wearing leather pants, riding around on a motorcycle, and he was just, you know. So I thought, this football playing judge in Jackson, like, that's my guy. And so he really became, you know, the basis for what Al Seed sounded like, and eventually, you know, sounded like.
Charlaine, you said something really interesting on one of the panels yesterday. You were saying how hearing the audiobook version of your books affects the way that you see, perceive the characters. Why is that, that hearing a voice actor read your books out loud changes things for you?
Just hearing your work interpreted through another medium can really give you a different perspective on your work. That sounds, you know, really pretentious, but it's quite true. Till I heard Joanna Parker read the book, I never realized how angry Sookie sounds out loud. When in my mind, she said the words she speaks without the edge of irritation. Joanna and Anna interpret Sookie as much more overtly angry than I ever knew I was writing her. And I thought, well, if they both see it the same way, then obviously there was something I didn't see there. But what's so weird is that now when I get taught in colleges, and I'm thinking, if I sat in one of the classes, would I recognize what they were talking about? Am I really that deep? I don't think so.
Joe, you read audiobooks. How does that differ from acting on TV?
Oh, man. Well, yeah, I read a couple of books in the past couple of years for Buzzy Multimedia, the Dragon Bones series. I've read the first two, Dragon Bones and Dragon Blood. And it's different because I'm doing all the voices. So it's a bit schizophrenic, especially in the scenes where you have, you know, two dwarves, a dragon, a warrior, a couple wizards, and I've got to do all the voices for all of them talking to each other. But it's a marathon. I mean, really, you lock yourself in a tiny little cubicle with a headset on, and you talk to yourself for about 5 hours straight. And then you come back again the next day and do it again. So, but yeah, it's a lot of fun. I love it. It's something I've always wanted to get into, and I've been fortunate to.
Do you have a producer there giving you feedback as you're doing it?
Yeah, sometimes they'll kind of interrupt me and push a button and go, that's the dwarf, not the elf, or, you know, whatever. You're like, oh, okay, sorry. And you're like, well, let's go back. And then you have to do it again.
Charlaine, if you ever wrote a book from a male point of view, would you consider having Joe do the audiobook?
It's interesting you should say that. When Paula and I made our entrance, she wanted to know what our scenario was, and we said, well, I'm a grieving Victorian widow who poisoned her husband. I mean, you got all that from the way I was talking, right? But she was the woman who'd been bopping the husband on the sly. We had an interesting gardener fantasy.
If I ever wrote a book from the male point of view, I would go to Joe first. Maybe an Al Seed book?
Yeah!
Shameless plug.
We'll take audience questions starting over there.
Yeah, one of my favorite things about the series is how well the actors really portray their characters. Like, we can believe that you as actors are those characters. It's just phenomenal work that you all have done, and I applaud all of you for your acting skills. But what I was going to wonder is, if you could branch out, if you could try to act as a different character on the series, who would you want to, all four of you, who would you want to attempt as a role?
Ooh.
Andy Belfleur.
try Jason Stackhouse.
It really is my favorite. Alright, so he blew it. He beat me to it. But I really do get to play my favorite part, which is awesome. But yeah, Lafayette. Ever since he served up that Ace burger, I just kind of wanted to do that.
Not to interrupt, but how about how brilliant Sam Trammell was at doing Tommy?
I had to bite the inside of my mouth to keep him laughing the whole time. Well, a lot of you know I've wanted to play a werewolf since the time I was a little boy, so I'm loving playing Alcide, but if I had to be somebody else, I don't know, maybe a ancient Roman, ancient Greek warrior who was turned into a vampire and is now king of some territory. I think that'd be pretty cool. King of Pennsylvania.
Oh my God. Well, I'm no kind of actress. I would love to play Hoyt's mom. I could do that.
It'd be hard to fight it out with you.
Maybe not as hard as you think.
Next question.
My question's for Kristen. Sorry, I have to compose myself. I admire you so much. I'm kind of losing my mind right now. Okay. Sorry.
I lost mine hours ago.
So oh my God.
We'll understand each other now.
All right. Bear with me, I'm sorry, everybody's staring at me too. Okay. I was wondering that I think it's the seventh episode where Pam gets the body peel and Dr. Ludwig says that even though she can make her beautiful on the outside again, that she's still decomposing on the inside.
Yeah.
But that hasn't really been brought up in the next few episodes, and they haven't talked about it.
Yeah.
And I was wondering if they were going to readdress that in the season finale or this next episode in some way, and why didn't Eric say anything about it when he came back? Because he should have remembered seeing her all, you know, Pam Roddy-ified and stuff.
You know, that's a question we all had because it was a big discussion. We didn't know if I just went from that, I called it jelly face in the coffin, you know, and then straight to the next episode, she's totally healed. So the producers decided that I would have veins painted on. They were pretty subtle. I thought they were really cool, so I kept trying to get them to make them darker. And then the next episode, it was a huge discussion in makeup. Do I still have the veins? I'm still rotting on the inside? Like, this conversation went on through the whole season. And to be honest, I don't know if we ever really came to a consensus. So I shouldn't totally ruin it, but there is somewhat of a resolve. And on the other question, I don't know that one either. You know, there's a couple of things that we just kind of chalked up to, oh, Eric lost his mind and he was busy. And he's still cute, you know?